In this lecture, what we are going to discuss means session hijacking. What is session hijacking? That means introduction. Session hijacking process. Types of session hijacking. Types of session hijacking. Spoofing versus hijacking. Levels of session hijacking. Session hijacking countermeasures. So these are the topics we are going to discuss in this lecture. So what is session hijacking? Okay, what is session hijacking? Now you can see, so I'm going to explain by using this example. Okay, you can see the screen. So by using this example, easily we can understand what is session hijacking. Now, so victim is a sender. Okay, this is a sender and this is a server. Okay, or we can say this is a client and a server machine. Now, so the client machine is sending the credentials. So credentials means the username and password. Now, credentials confirmation, that means, so the victim, or we can say it's a client, is now authenticator. Okay, just take myself. This is my computer. I'm going to, okay, take my browser. Okay, I'm going to bangmuscat.com. I'm giving my username and password. Okay, I'm giving my username and password. So the username and password is sent to the web server and they are validating, they are checking it. Yes. So the username and password, the given username and password is correct. Now, so the credentials confirmed. That means, okay, the user is authenticated. The client is authenticated. Then once you are authenticated, so there will be a session established. Okay, we are going to use the TCP protocol. Using the TCP protocol, okay, a connection will be established. Okay, so this is, we are going to say, as a session. So a session is, okay, established between the client and the server. Okay, so once the session is established, okay, now between my computer and your computer, a session has been established. So first you are joining the meeting. Okay, I'm going to authenticate you. I'm going to see your name. I'm seeing your, okay, your email ID, and I'm going to allow you. So once if I allow you, means authentication is over. You are authenticated. So once authenticated, between my machine and your machine, okay, a connection, okay? So a session is now established. Now we are now in this session and we are sending and receiving some data. Okay, already a session is created between my machine and your machine. Using this particular session or on this session, okay, I'm just talking to you. This is the data. So this data is reaching you and you are telling something, okay, and it is reaching me. Now, once the session is set up, okay, once the session is set up, so we are going to request some data, okay, data transmission, okay, sending and receiving the data. Make it very simple. Sending and receiving the data is going on. Now, the attacker. So what the attacker is going to do means the attacker is going to sniff this traffic. Okay, what is sniffing? In the previous lecture, we discussed. Okay, in the previous lecture, we talk about what is sniffing, what are the types of sniffing, okay, how the sniffing is taking place, we discussed. Now, so the attacker is going to sniff it. Okay, he's going to take a copy of that. Okay, he's taking a copy of the packets. Now, from this packet, he is going to find some technical information. Okay, the attacker is going to find some technical information. Now, using what is that information? We will see it later. Now, using that information, the attacker will make the victim down and then the attacker will be connected with the server. So this is called session hijacking. Session hijacking. Okay, in another way, in a very simple way, I will tell. See, a client machine, a server machine, they are connected. So they are now communicating. This is called a session. They are in a session. So for every session, there will be an ID. Okay, a session ID will be used. Okay, a session ID will be used. I will show that. Now, using session ID, so the attacker is going to listen this traffic. From this, the attacker is going to take the session ID. And using the session ID, attacker is started communicating with the server without any authentication. Okay, without doing any authentication. So simply, okay, the attacker can communicate. This is called session hijacking. Okay, see, what is session hijacking means? This is an attack. Attacker takes over a valid TCP communication session. Okay, how you will understand everything slowly, don't worry. So the attacker is going to take over of a valid TCP communication session between two computers, okay, between two computers, and then, okay, between two computers, and then the attacker is going to use it. Then most authentication, okay, actually first time is authenticated here, it is authenticated only here. But after this, there is no authentication. No need to do any authentication. Only authentication will be done at the time of, okay, establishing the connection. So once the session is created, okay, they are not going to do any authentication. So attacker can sniff it, and easily attacker can use the session ID, and the attacker can communicate with the target. This is called session hijacking. Okay, if you are not understanding, there is nothing. Okay, no need to worry at this stage. Okay, in the coming slides, okay, things will be technically we are discussing, and okay, it will be very clear for you. Now I'm going for the next slide. Okay, you can understand here. Now you see, this is a server machine. Okay, a server machine, I'm having a server machine here. Now a client machine is going to communicate. Okay, so just now, so this is a server machine. Okay, so this is a client machine. Now the client machine is communicating with the server machine. So first, okay, they are going to do the authentication, then a session will be established, then they are going to communicate with each other. Now I'm using a device, the attacker is using a device. So what is this device? This is a sniffing device. Okay, for example, you can take, it could be a switch, or it could be a modem, okay, any device. Now, so whatever the packets coming here, okay, the attacker is taking the copy of the packet. Attacker is going to learn something from the packets. Okay, the attacker is learning something from the packet. So by using that information, now the attacker is going to communicate, okay, I am the victim. So I am the victim. He is going to communicate with the server. So without any authentication, the server can communicate with him. Okay, because already in the existing session, the session is already created. So authentication will be done only once. After that, okay, the attacker can easily communicate with this person. Then the attacker is going to, you see the reset or ST. So he is going to reset. Okay, he is going to switch off from this particular communication. So this is called session hijacking concept. Okay, now you can see technically here, what is session hijacking means? Okay, so what is session hijacking means? Exploiting the weakness available in the TCP protocol and the network communication and taking over a real connection or taking over a connection. So here, sniffing, you need a component for sniffing. Okay, now this is the component for sniffing. The sniffing taking place here. Okay, taking place here. Now the attacker is sniffing all the packets. So from the packets, he is learning something. What he is learning, we will see in the next slide. He is learning something from the packets. So using that information, so attacker can directly communicate with the server without, okay, any authentication. No need to do any authentication here. So easily he can communicate with this person. Now you can see what are the steps, simple steps we are giving here. Identify a active session. So between you and me, between your computer and my computer, there is an active session available now. Somebody can, okay, monitor, somebody can capture these packets. From that packet, there will be something called a sequence number. Okay, a session ID will be available. Session ID, we discussed in the previous slide. Then we have some sequence numbers. So using this session ID and sequence numbers, the attackers can easily communicate. Now take one of the parties offline. Now make this person offline, and then this person is going to communicate with me. So takes control of the session. So the previous lecture is going to be the base. Sniffing is going to be the base. So while sniffing the packet, while capturing Ado's packet, you can open the packet and you can find some technical information regarding the connections. What is that? You can find the session ID. You can find the sequence numbers. So by using the session ID and sequence numbers, so the attacker can easily communicate without any authentication. Easily he can communicate with the server. Now further, okay, we are going for the next slide. You will understand better. Now you can see here why session hijacking is successful. Okay, session hijacking is going to be a very easy one. It is going to be a very easy target. Okay, so what is that? Session IDs may be used in the URL. Okay, whenever you are communicating with any servers. So session IDs are used with the URL. URL means, you know, the web address, website address. Okay, I will show this. In my machine, I'm going to take bankmuscatonline.com. I'm going to log in into the bankmuscat and I will copy this URL. Okay, I'm going to copy the URL and you can find there is a session ID will be available. So I'm doing from my machine, so I can see. But the attacker is capturing my packets means even the attackers can see the session ID. So using the session ID, the attacker can communicate from his machine with the bankmuscat without authentications. Okay, they can communicate. Now, so session IDs may be used in the URL. It is not maybe, it is used. It is used in the URL. Okay, that means the uniform resource locator URL means the website address. Then no account lockout for invalid session IDs. Suppose if an invalid session ID I'm using means, okay, I'm using an invalid session ID, I'm communicating with the server names, the account is not going to be locked. Simply they will tell it is invalid, that's it. Okay, I'm a hacker, I'm going to use an invalid session ID, okay, invalid session ID, and I'm communicating with the bank server names, so it is not going to block anything. You simply say, okay, the session ID is invalid. Then, indefinite session expiration. Some systems, okay, if you go for bankmuscat, they have the time limit. You can log in and without doing anything, you can just leave it only for 2 or 3 minutes. After 2 or 3 minutes, okay, the session will be expired. Okay, the session will be expired. But in some servers, in some applications, they are not at all checking this expiration. They will never check about this expiry. So they are keep on, okay, they keep on using the same session for very long. That is going to be very dangerous. Then weak session IDs. Easily the session IDs, you can guess. Okay, easily you can guess the session ID. Okay, in many applications, okay, they are using weak session IDs. So automatically the session IDs can be guessed by the people, by the attacker. Most computers using TCP/IP are vulnerable. So there are a lot of vulnerabilities available in the TCP protocol. Okay, so we cannot say TCP/IP protocol is a robust, it is a strong protocol. No. So it is having a lot of weaknesses, vulnerabilities available. So attackers can use these vulnerabilities. Then insecure handling of session IDs. Actually, session IDs is not encrypted anywhere. Session IDs is going to be kept open. So if anybody can capture a session ID names, so using that session ID, okay, the attackers can manipulate and they can enter into the server. So what is the countermeasures? There are so many countermeasures available. How you can stop session hijacking? We are going to discuss in the same lecture at the end. But most of these countermeasures do not work. Okay, do not work unless encryption is used. Okay, so encryption is going to be a important one. If you want to avoid hijacking, session hijacking means, so encryption plays a major role here. Okay, so this is how hijacking is successful. Then the next one, session hijacking process. Okay, now meanwhile, what I'm going to do, I'm just going to take bankmuscat. Okay, I'm going to the bankmuscatonline.com. Okay, and I will show you the session ID, my session ID. Okay, so that you can understand very easily. I am now Okay, I'll just share. I'm going to copy the session IDs of that of the victim, and the attackers will use this and they will enter into the server machines. So this concept is called session hijacking concept. Now, the next one, okay, I'm going for session hijacking process. So what is session hijacking process, or how it works? Okay, how it works. Now, it is working in three different steps. There are three different phases, or we can say three different steps. So the first step is called stealing. Second step is going to be the guessing. The third step is going to be brute forcing. Okay, what is stealing? Okay, just now I explained. So your attacker is going to steal your packets. Okay, he's going to sniff your packets. Okay, it can be in any layer, in layer 3 or in layer 7. So the attacker is going to sniff. Okay, you can see attacker uses different techniques to steal the session IDs. So they are going to use a different techniques. There are a lot of techniques available. So what are the techniques? We already discussed in the previous lecture, sniffing techniques. Okay, so using the sniffing techniques, the attacker is going to sniff your packets. Then from the packets, they are going to steal the session IDs. They are going to steal. So what are the different techniques available means? So different techniques means using the HTTP referrer header, HTTP header. Okay, using this is layer 7. In layer 7, okay, you can do sniffing. Sniffing in the network traffic. Then there is another concept called cross-site scripting. This we are going to see in coming lectures. Then sending the Trojans to the client machines and finding the session ID. So there are different techniques available, but the popular technique is sniffing. Sniffing is a very popular one. So without, it is a passive, a passive step. You can collect the packet of others. You can do some analysis in there, take the session IDs, use the session IDs, and then, okay, they will communicate with the server machines. Then the next one you can see, guessing. So what is guessing means? The attacker tries to guess the session IDs by observing the variable ports of the session IDs. So now the attacker is going to guess. Okay, for example, see here, hack.com view. Okay, if this is going to be a session ID, if this is the session ID XA234489, then what could be the next session ID? So the attackers can guess like this. Okay, you see XA, then 234, then 489 is coming, then 569 is coming. Okay, then there is another number. So then what could be the next one? What could be the next session ID? So they can guess. Suppose Bank Muscat is creating like this. For first user, the session ID is 1. For the second user, the session ID is 2. For the third user, session ID is 4. Means, so easily, okay, the attacker will guess the next will be 5, next will be 6, next will be 7. So the attacker can guess the session ID from one session ID. Okay, so this is, so, okay, that means guessing the session IDs. So if it is success, automatically the attacker will enter into the machine. Okay, we don't know who is the client. We don't know that, but you can guess and you can enter. So this is going to be the session, okay, IDs guessing. Then the next one is going to be the brute forcing. So what is brute forcing means? The attacker attempts different IDs until he succeeds. Okay, he's going to use different IDs. Okay, guessing, brute forcing, it is different. Guessing means you will have some logic in there. Okay, first session ID is 1 means next is going to be 2. If it is 2 means next is going to be 3. So there will be some logic in that, in guessing. But in brute forcing, there won't be any logic. Okay, simply predicting. Okay, like he is going to predict. Prediction. So simply he is going to try with it random session IDs and then trying to enter into the server machine. Okay, so these are the three different methods. So where we can, okay, the hijacking process is going on there. The next one, you can see session hijacking process. There are major 5 steps available. The first step is called sniffing. Next one is going to be monitoring. Next, session desynchronization. Session ID prediction. Then command injection. This is the proper steps. Whatever we discussed so far, we are now arranging in 5 different steps: sniffing, monitoring, session desynchronization, session ID prediction, then command injection. Now, let me go to the first one. What is sniffing? We already know. So sniffing means two parties, they are going to communicate with each other. Two parties, they are communicating with each other. This is going to be a client machine and this is the server machine. So both, they are going to communicate with each other, a third party, a third person, in a passive way, not active, in a passive way, is going to monitor all the traffic, which is sent and received between the client and server. So now, once if you capture these packets, so the packets will be opened, the data in the packet is encrypted. We don't want that. But we need the header information. What is the session ID? So the information related to the transport, the network, we are going to take. So step number one is sniffing. This is the last lecture. We discussed about different types of sniffing. Then the next step, after sniffing, I'm going for monitor. So what is monitor means? Monitor the flow of packets and predict the sequence number. There are two things we are going to take. One is called the sequence number and second one is called the session ID. Two things, I repeat. Session ID and sequence number. So session ID is going to be one session ID. Inside the session ID, there will be a lot of sequence number. Sequence number means first I send one packet, sequence number 10. And I'm going to get the reply. Reply is going to be 11. Then I will send 12, packet number 12, packet number 13. So this is going to be the sequence number. It will be clear in the coming slides. So monitor the flow of packet, from where to where the packet is going on, from client to server, server to client. What is the sequence numbers they are using? One session ID, this is one session. Between my computer and your computer, there is one session. Only one session is going on now. For example, session ID is 100. I'm sending one packet now. For every set packet, there will be a different sequence number. A sequence number is going to come now. So you have to monitor and observe this. This is going to be the second step. Monitor the flow of packets and predict the sequence numbers. Now, the next step is going to be, session desynchronization. What is desynchronization? Now I got all the information. I know what is the session ID. I know what is the sequence numbers they are using. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to cut off. I'm going to remove this person. So in the name of server, I'm giving a reset command. Reset command if I give, what is happening? So now the client machine is going to be detached, is going to be removed, is going to be disconnected. So the client machine is now disconnected from this communication. Logically is now not in the connection. Now the attacker is going to take the session ID, take over the session. So by using the session ID, and then we know the sequence number, how they are communicating. So I know the session ID, I know the sequence numbers. So by using this information, the attacker is going to communicate with the session. So without any authentication, suppose if there is anything wrong in this means, no need to worry. The machine server is going to say your session ID is not correct. The account is not going to be locked. Whatever the account, the original account you are using, it is not going to be locked. The username and password, the username is not going to be locked. Only it is going to say it is an invalid number, invalid sequence number, or invalid session ID. So automatically it will be disconnected. Then the next step is going to be command injection. So what is command injection means? So once if you are connected, you can do anything. You can inject some unwanted software. You can inject some bad dose. You can inject some antivirus. So anything, the attacker may inject, Okay, he may enter anything into the server so that the server will become, okay, it is security is compromised here. So, okay, I'm just installing some virus. Okay, some malicious software he can inject. Using that, okay, automatically he can enter into the server and he can do whatever he wants. So these are the six different steps: sniffing, monitoring, session desynchronization, session ID prediction, and command injection. Okay, so these are the six different steps. Okay, sorry, five different, not six, five steps. Okay, which is available in the session hijacking process. Now we are going to see technically. Okay, we are going to see technically how it works. Now you can see I have two machines. This is a client machine and this is a server machine. Now, so between them, they are going to establish a session. Okay, they are going to establish a session. So the session ID is going to be one. Okay, only one session ID. Okay, session ID, let it be Android. Now, the attacker, what the attacker is doing, the attacker is monitoring all the traffic which is going between them. Okay, the attacker is monitoring. Okay, now, what is the first packet means? I'm going to send the sync packet. Okay, I want to establish a connection, a TCP connection between a client, between a server and me. So I'm sending, okay, a sync packet. Sync packet is going. Now, for this sync packet, I'm going to get the acknowledgement packet. Okay, you can see ACK, acknowledgement, and then sync of the server. Okay, you can see sync of the client. CLT is a client. Okay, now he is going to give the sync of the server. Okay, sync of the server, and then he is going to give the acknowledgement. Okay, he's giving the acknowledgement. Now the acknowledgement is coming to me. Now I have to give the acknowledgement. Okay, I'm giving the acknowledgement. Okay, I'm giving the acknowledgement, and the client is giving the acknowledgement. So these three steps, connection is established, authentication is over. Then the next step is going to be, okay, the next step is going to be, okay, data exchange. So the attacker, okay, that means the client is asking something, some data, and this person is going to give some data. Okay, so requesting the data and getting the data. Okay, now you see what is happening means, see, this is the sync. Okay, then this is the client, CLET. Okay, CLT is the client. Then he is using a sequence number, SN. What is the sequence number means? He is going to start from 1200. 1200 is the sequence number this person is starting. Then the next one is Win512. This is going to be the window size. Okay, window size means, so what is the amount of data, okay, he can receive at a time. Okay, so window size is not an issue here. Window size, okay, that means the size of the data. But sequence number is very important. Sequence number is going to start from 1200. Now, the next one you can see, this person, that means the server machine, okay, sending the sync server, SVR server. Now, he is using this, okay, number. What is the sequence number he is using means 1500 is the sequence number he is going to start. So randomly from thousands, okay, 500 is starting. Now you can see the window size. Okay, window size is 1024 bytes, that you don't need to worry. So sequence number is 1500. I'm going to give the acknowledgement. What is acknowledgement means? You see, already 1200 is a sequence number. Okay, the sync is coming. So plus one, 1201. In 1201, I'm sending the acknowledgement. So what we understand from this particular scenario, client is using the sequence number from 1200, he's starting from 1200. And this person, that means the machine, that means the server, it is starting from 1500. Okay, for session establishment. Now you see, I want to give the reply. What is the reply? I'm giving the acknowledgement. That means the acknowledgement is going from the client. So what is the sequence number he is using means 1501. Okay, because already we received 1500 here. So in 1501, okay, I'm giving the acknowledgement. Okay, session created, session is successful. Okay, a logical connection is available. TCP connection is now available. Okay, now, okay, I'm sending the data. Okay, data or request or a packet, anything. Okay, this client machine is sending a packet. Okay, so this is going to be the size of the packet. Okay, no need to worry about it. You see the sequence number. So what is the sequence number? Now he is using range 1201 is the sequence number he is using. Okay, 1201 is a sequence number. Okay, now this person, the client machine is going to reply. Okay, is going to reply on 1329. He is going to reply. So now the attacker is monitoring this sequence number. The attacker is monitoring. Okay, is monitoring. Okay, the sequence numbers already session ID. I got it. Session ID in the beginning. Only one session ID. Then the sequence numbers is going to be different sequence number they are using. Once if you know the sequence numbers by using this, okay, now the attacker is going to communicate. Okay, so the attacker now started communicating 1240. So 1240, okay, it is going to be the, okay, that means sequence number, it will increase. Okay, it will increase one by one, okay, depending upon the size. So automatically the size is going to increase. So now he is going to predict, okay, this, what is it? The sequence number. So using the sequence number, okay, the attacker is going to communicate with this machine. So this data, once if you got this data, okay, automatically, okay, you can communicate. Okay, you can communicate with the machine. So this is how, okay, the session hijacking concept is working. Now you can see, before the user could send the next data packets, the attacker predicts the next sequence number. What will be the sequence, next sequence number? So using that particular sequence number, okay, so he is going to take over the connection. So the attacker is going to take over the connection. Then, okay, automatically this person will be removed from this. Your server will communicating with the attacker without doing any authentication. Okay, without doing any authentication, okay, it will communicate with the hacker. So this is how, okay, the session hijacking session, okay, session hijacking concept is working. Now, in the next slide, you can see types of session hijacking. There are two different types. One is called the active and second one is called the passive. Okay, in active session hijacking, attacker finds an active session and takes over. That means they will be connected. X and Y will be connected. Now the attacker is, okay, joining in that and removing X. Okay, attacker will become a part of that communication. What is passive means? So in the passive, attacker hijacks a session and sits back and watches and record all the traffic that has been sent. So in a passive, he is going to simply watch. Okay, watch all the transactions, whatever, everything, okay, is going to see. See, if you are not in the session, you can capture the packet, but the packet will be encrypted. The data will be encrypted. You are in the part of session. You are in the part of session and you are going to listen. You are going to monitor. So in that case, okay, you can find everything. Okay, in an unencrypted format, you will get everything. The attacker will get everything. So that is going to be the passive attack. I repeat these points. What is active means? So you and me, my machine and your machine are connected. Somebody is going to capture this session. Somebody is going to see what is the sequence number and somebody is going to join. And they will cut one person between, okay, between my machine and your machine, one will be detached, desynchronized. Okay, that is active. But in the passive, okay, X and Y will be connected. At the same time, attacker is also in that connection and he is going to monitor everything between the X and Y. Okay, so that is going to be the passive attack. Now, the next topic is going to be snoofing versus hijacking. We already studied about this IP snoofing, hijacking. Between this, what is the difference? Lot of difference. So what is that lot of difference means? Okay, you can see this is snoofing. Snoofing means we already studied. You take somebody's IP address. Okay, you're going to take somebody's IP address and you are going to prove I am this person. That is called, okay, snoofing. Okay, see. So Ali, so Ali's credentials, okay, the attacker is going to take. And he is going to, the attacker is going to claim that is I am Ali. Okay, this is called okay snoofing. Snoofing, you are going to use somebody's okay credential, somebody's ID, okay, somebody's okay username, password, you are going to use. But here it is not like that. Okay, X and Y are connected. Using that particular connection, I am monitoring that communication. From that communication, I'm learning about the session IDs and the sequence numbers. By using the session IDs and sequence numbers, I'm going to okay desynchronize. I'm going to remove him. Then I'm going to take over the connection. Here, the success rate will be very less. Okay, the success rate will be very less because you must know everything clearly about Ali. Then only okay, this is going to be success. But here it is not like that. Here the success will be very high. If you monitor someone, it is enough. So technically in layer 4, layer 3, layer 7, if you monitor a person, you will get a lot of information. So using that information, you can easily take over the session. Okay, so this is the difference between the spoofing and hijacking. Now, the next one, you can see there are two levels of session hijacking is available. Okay, this is just the previous slide I took. In the networking level, hijacking. In the application level, hijacking. Okay, from Mac, from BankMuscat, just now I have shown you the session ID. That is going to be the application level. I'm using a browser. From the browser, I just go to the URL. I'm going to copy that URL. And I'm going to see what is the session ID available. So that is going to be the HTTP, okay, session hijacking. So each and every packet you are going to capture, open the packet and see what is the sequence number you are using. So what could be the next sequence number you can predict. Okay, a server will follow a different method of generating the session, what is that, sequence numbers. So you can predict what is the sequence number. For example, sequence number 1. Then sequence number 5 they are using, then sequence number 10 they are using, then 15 means they are going in multiples of 5. Some system they can use, okay, 100, 200, 300, 400, they can use the sequence number like this. So if they are using a sequence number like this, you can easily predict, okay, what could be the next one. So this is okay prediction. Okay, you have to predict. That means the attacker will predict the next session ID. Okay, sorry, next sequence number, and they can easily okay use that and they can enter into your machine. See, there are two different types available. The first level is the networking level, and then next level is going to be the application level. If you go for the networking level, you can do the TCP session hijacking and UDP session hijacking. So these are the two different protocols. Okay, the protocols which will be used for communication, TCP and UDP. Okay, these two things you can do in the network level. And in the application level, you can go for the, okay, HTTP. So this is what the example given. Now, I'm going for one by one. So we are going for the network level. So network level, what you have to do, you have to sniff the packet. Okay, you have to sniff the packet. In any method. So you have to sniff the packets. Yeah, attacker, it is an attack on the data flow of the protocol. Data flow means, okay, communication across the web applications, across two different machines, they are going to communicate all the traffic you are going to take. So network level hijacking relies on hijacking transport and the internet protocol, layer 3, layer 4. So network layer and transport layer. So in the three layers, so there are two layers. In the network layer, layer 3 and layer 4. In the layer 3 and layer 4, we are going to sniff all the packets between X and Y. From the packets, you can do the analysis and you can find, okay, the session ID and the sequence numbers you can take. Now, if you go for the network level hijacking, there are two types available. One is the TCP session hijacking. Then the second one is the UDP session hijacking. Now I'm going for the TCP. Already we discussed this in slide number 13. The same concept is coming. So what is that? See, this is a client machine and this is the server machine. So the server sends, a data packet. Okay, that means they are communicating. They are communicating with each other. Now the attacker is going to monitor all the packets. He is going to monitor. He is going to monitor all the packets. Now you see, you can take one packet now. So I'm just going to take only one packet, a single packet I'm going to take, and I'm going to see what are the information available there. So you can see here, source. You just take this packet and see source. Source IP address 10.75.1.100. This is the IP address of the source machine. Then destination IP address of the destination machine 10.75.1.200. This is the IP address of the destination machine. Sequence number. What is the sequence number main? This is the sequence number they are using. So 25487960. A very big sequence number he is using. Acknowledgement. For acknowledgement, he is using 21458610. Then the length of the packet is going to be 64. 64 bits or 64 bytes. We can keep it anything. So what I got? I got the sequence number of the client machine. This is. And then acknowledgement, for the server machine. That means acknowledgement means they will add something. The sequence number of the server machine plus one. Generally, it should be one, but we can see. Now, I observe the next packet. I'm going for observing the next packet. So you see the next packet. Now the source is 10.75.1.200. 200 means, that means this machine. Destination is 10.75.1.100. The client machine. Now, what is the session number he is using? Means 21458610 is the session number, sequence number he is using. Next one, he is giving the acknowledgement. Acknowledgement, he is going to give the acknowledgement. See, this is the sequence number he is giving, 25487960. For this sequence number, the acknowledgement is 2588024. He is giving 24 now. So using this information, what could be the next sequence number means the client is going to use this as the next sequence number. A very simple logic. So acknowledgement is this means this machine, the client machine will send the next sequence number with this. Now you see the attacker. The attacker is now creating a packet source. This is source. He is using the IP address of the client. Destination is the IP address of the server, but what is the sequence number he is using? The sequence number, he is taking this acknowledgement number and he is going to use this as a sequence number. You got it. So now this is he is predicting, because this two transaction is telling like that. Whatever the acknowledgement he is sending, the acknowledgement now used as the sync. Same. Now he is sending the acknowledgement this. So I'm going to use this as the sequence number. Finished. So this is the way, how you can predict. So this is what we discussed in the previous slides. So there are five steps available in this. I think in the fourth step or third step, we discussed about this is how you can guess. The attacker is going to guess. If you monitor your communication, so easily you can guess. So what is the sequence numbers, of the client? What is the sequence number of the server? So how they are exchanging, how they are incrementing the values. So automatically the attacker can use it and they can enter into it. So this is the TCP session hijacking. Now go to the UDP session hijacking. In UDP session hijacking, it is very easy. Because we already studied in many places. So UDP is going to be a, it is an unreliable protocol. It is an unreliable protocol. Here, there is nothing like sync, acknowledgement, nothing like that. So simply you are going to send the packet and you are going to get the reply. Now you see, The attacker sends forged server reply to the victim's UDP request before the intended server replies to it. So what does that mean? The attacker sends a forged server reply. Okay, now you see. Okay, the client is sending some request. Okay, so the client is sending some request to the server, UDP request. Here there is no sync, nothing. Now the attacker is monitoring this. Okay, the attacker is monitoring this. Now what the attacker is going to do? The attacker is going to give the reply based on the information available. The attacker is giving a reply, a forged information the attacker is going to give. Okay, so attacker sends a forged server reply to the victim's UDP request before the server replies to it. Then next step, the attacker uses the man in the middle attack. Now, okay, the attacker is available here to intercept the server's response to the client and sends its own forged reply. Okay, now, so this person is going to take, okay, that means the attacker is going to take the server's reply and he is going to do some forging, okay, forges, okay, anything. The first step also he can do, the second step also he can do. So whatever the reply coming from the UDP server, he is going to make some changes in that and it can send it. Or directly this person can give some reply, server replies, okay, directly he can do reply. So session hijacking in UDP is going to be very easy, but in most of the cases we are not going to use the UDP. Okay, in UDP communication you cannot find any valid information, you cannot find. Okay, just for data collection you can use the UDP, but if you need any personal data, okay, the personal data about the users and all, you have to go for the TCP hijacking only. Now, the third is going to be application level hijacking. So in application level hijacking, we are going to use the HTTP, that means from the browsers. Okay, you see session IDs. So you can use the session IDs, okay, as far as the application level hijacking is concerned. I have shown this example using the band muskets. So you can just go to the URL and you can copy the URL, okay, from the session ID. The same session ID will be used. Okay, the session ID will be used by the attackers and he can enter, he can establish a connection between, okay, him and the server and take all the data, whatever they want. So these are the three different levels, okay. So one is the network level and application level. In the network level, TCP, UDP, and in the application level, this is completely based on the HTTP. In the network level, mainly you are using the sequence numbers. In the application levels, you will be using the session IDs. Okay, session IDs. Okay, this is the major concept of this lecture. Now, application level hijacking, there are different techniques. Okay, there are different techniques available. So what are the different techniques? Means one is going to be sniffing, session sniffing. The same thing, it is for application level or network level, it is going to be the same way. You have to sniff. Okay, the attacker is going to sniff the packet between exchange between the sender and the receiver. Okay, so session hijacking, man in the middle attack, cross-site scripting attack, session replay attack, okay, predictable session token, cross-site request forgery, session fixation. These are all different, okay, methods available. Okay, you can take the session ID, that means the session token or session ID, you can take in a different ways. There are different methods. Even there are some tools available. Okay, we are going to see what are the tools. So using any of these techniques, either session sniffing technique, man in the middle attack technique, or cross-site scripting. Okay, the cross-site scripting we are going to study in some lecture, I think last lecture, I think. Then session replay attack, predictable session attack, okay, CSR, cross-site request forgery. So in many techniques, okay, different techniques are used. Okay, by using these techniques, you can take the session ID of, okay, of between two people, okay, between a sender and a receiver. Now, we are just talking about, okay, the session hijacking using HTTP. Okay, you can see. I have shown for the band musket, a very big session ID was there. Now, you can see generally how the session IDs will be generated. Okay, if you take BankMuskets server, BankMuskets machine will be communicating with many people in the world. Now, for every user, they have to give a different session ID. So how these session IDs are created? There are a lot of methods available for creating this session ID. One of the simple method you can see. So what is this means? Now you see, this is one session ID from testhack.com. This is the first session ID created. This is the second session ID, third session ID, fourth session ID, fifth session ID. Now, by seeing this, you cannot understand anything. You cannot understand anything from these session IDs. But if you watch it closely, it is nothing. So what does that mean? You see, SF, 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 this is going to be a constant one. Okay, SF is going to be the constant. Okay, so I take SF. Now, 2008, what is the 2008 means? That is going to be the year. Okay, 2008 is a year. Okay, 2008, 2008, 2008. Then the next one is going to be, okay, 20. So 20, this is going to be the date. Okay, this is going to be the date. So 20th. So 2017, oh, okay, the last one they are taking it as year. Okay, no problem. You see, now 2017, 2017, 17, 17. This is going to be the year. Then, 10th October, it is not 10th October. This is 28. Okay, so this is wrong. The explanation is wrong. But anyway, so what you understand, see, 2017, 2017, 2017, 17. This is going to be the year. Okay, this is the year. 20 is the date. 20 is the date and 8 is the month. Okay, so this is going to be 20th August. 20th August. So now, okay, they are giving 10th November. This is wrong. So this is going to be the date. Then the next one is going to be the time. The next one is going to be the time. So what is the time? So 10, 12, 22 seconds. 10, 24, okay, 26 seconds. So 10, 47, 32 seconds. Now, if you combine everything, this is going to be a session ID. Okay, this is going to be the session ID. Okay, now, easily attacker can predict what is going to be the next session ID. I can predict. Okay, I can easily predict. What could be the next means? I'm going to take everything here. 2008, 207, 1132. Okay, after this 17, I write 18191. Okay, 1920, 2021. I can try different. So if I try different, any one is going to be the success. Okay, I repeat. See, 2008, 2017, 1132. Okay, or 11 up to 11 o'clock. This is going to be the constant. Then 11:32, 17. So what I can do? 30:32, 18. 32:19, 32:20, 32:21. So I can guess like this. So the attacker can guess like this. So the attacker is guessing like this means if it is invalid, it is going to say invalid. That's it. It is not going to block any account. So let me try different. So in any the server machines, okay, for generating the session IDs, they have to be very strong. The next one you can see, tools, session hijacking. Tools. There are a lot of session hijacking tools available. So here only there are three different tools given to you. One is ZapProxy, Burpshoot, and Deroid Sheet. So these are all the tools which could be used for session hijacking. So if you go for the first one, ZapProxy means, so this is going to be a web application, finding the vulnerabilities in the web applications. Burpshoot, so this is modifying, inspecting, and this is a very powerful tool actually. So this tool is going to inspect and modify the traffic between the browser and the target applications. Then Deroid Sheet, this is also, okay, this is for mobile applications, okay, application for mobile devices. So Android based tool. So because many people nowadays we are using, okay, many apps. So even the apps you can, they are using the session IDs. So you can take the session IDs by using this particular course. Okay, so then not only this, okay, a very big list is available, but only three different tools are given to you. Now, so the next one, deduction methods. Okay, session hijacking countermeasures. Okay, how can I avoid? How can I avoid? Okay, a session hijacking. So I am having a server. I don't want any session hijacking in my server. So what I can do means you can. Okay, first you have to go for the detection methods. You have to detect somebody is doing session hijacking. You have to find it. So there are two methods available. One is a manual method, and second one is an automatic method. So if you go for automatic methods, okay, you have to use okay IDS, intrusion detection systems, or intrusion prevention systems we can use. So intrusion prevention we are going to study. Okay, I think lecture number 13, intrusion prevention system. So you can use either a intrusion detection system, or we can use a intrusion prevention system. Okay, and this will automatically detect. Okay, any session hijacking is going on there. Manually you can go. What, how you can do manually means by using some packet sniffing software like Wireshark. Okay, there are so many tools available. Okay, for capturing the packets. So you can use any of these tools. You can capture the packets and you can do the analysis of your own. Okay, so normal TCP telnet session or forcing an ARP entry. So these are all different techniques, but this is enough. So using packet sniffing softwares, you can capture your own packets and you can do some analysis and you can find anybody is doing session hijacking or not. Okay, so this is how you can do the countermeasures, how you can stop. So not only this, so what you have to follow. Okay, you are having a web server, website, a very popular website. Okay, take BankMuscat. So what they have to do means create session keys with the lengthy strings. So the length of the session ID should be long. If you use a very short session ID, problem. Then use the random numbers. Don't use the same sequence numbers. Your session ID should be very strong. You have to use random numbers. Don't use, okay, sequence number 10, 20, 30, 40 like that. So easily the attacker will guess. So make it difficult for the attacker to guess. Then regenerate the session ID after successful login. Okay, this is another important one. Once if you log in, once somebody log in, create a new, give them a new session ID for them so that the attackers cannot find it. Then encrypt all the data and the session key that is transferred between the user and the web server. Okay, this is not at all happening. Okay, so only in some servers they are doing it, but most of the servers they are not doing it. Okay, so all the transactions including the session ID, everything you have to encrypt. Then the entire session, okay, sorry, expire the session as soon as the user logs out. So if somebody is logging out, immediately you have to close the session. Okay, you should not keep it on for long. Reduce the lifespan of the session. Okay, you see, between my machine and your machine, almost 1 hour we are connected. So the session is going for more than 1 hour. So you should not have a very long sessions. If you have a very long session between a server and a client, okay, for example, between my machine and BankMuscat, okay, it's dangerous. So the session should be very short, okay? Then only you can avoid sniffing. Then to be followed by the users. Okay, I'm the user, you and me are the users. So what you have to do, you and me have to do means, don't click the links that are received through the emails. So anything if you are receiving through email, kindly don't click on that. Use firewalls, use firewall to prevent the malicious, okay, entry. Use firewall and the browser settings to restrict the cookies. Okay, cookies is going to be a very big problem. So using the cookies also easily, okay, session hijacking is going on. Then you can verify any website if you are communicating. Please verify they have digital certificates. Okay, they must have a digital certificate. Okay, so from CA, certification authorities. So you have to verify the digital certificate of any server you are communicating. Clear your history always, okay, in the browser. Please clear your history frequently. Offline content and cookies, everything should be clear. Okay, you have to clear everything. Don't save the passwords. Many people, what they will do means they will save the passwords. Okay, the password should be saved in the browsers. That is also a risky one. Log out from the browser. Okay, this is another one. most of the people are not doing for login. Okay, you have to log in into your browsers. Okay, so that should be a login facility. The login facility is available for the browsers. So you have to log in, you can browse, then you have to log out and come from the browsers. So instead of closing the browsers. So these are all the different countermeasures as a user. Okay, you and me. Okay, you and me have to take. So what we discussed means we discussed about what is session hijacking, process. Okay, snoofing versus hijacking, levels of session hijacking, and then session hijacking countermeasures. Okay, so these are the topics we discussed in this particular lecture. Okay, thank you very much. So I will close the lecture today.